mejores se siente. Y la marca, la marca de...
Thank you. So for the thanks to Jesus for that wonderful 40 hours of grace that he gave us this week. And so as we prepare to celebrate Mass today, this 15th Sunday of Ordinary Time, as we prepare to offer all of our prayers and petitions before the Lord, as we prepare to remember those who asked us for our prayers, to remember those who haven't asked us for their prayers, but we know they need them anyway. As we prepare to offer all of this to Jesus this morning, let's first of all pause and remind ourselves how all of us come here this morning in need of his love, how all of us have come here this morning in need of his forgiveness. You were sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to people of good will. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you.
We give you thanks for your great glory.
Lord God, heavenly King, O God, almighty Father, Lord Jesus Christ, only your God's Son, Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father,
you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. You take away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, have mercy on us.
For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord,
you alone are the Most High Jesus Christ,
with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let us pray. O God, who in the abasement of your Son have raised up a fallen world, fill your faithful with holy joy. For on those you have rescued from slavery to sin, you bestow eternal gladness. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the prophet Ezekiel. The Spirit came into me and made me stand up, and I heard the Lord speaking to me. He said, Son of man, I'm sending you to the Israelites, to the rebels who have turned against me. Till now, they and their ancestors have been in revolt against me. The sons are defiant and obstinate. I am sending you to them to say, the Lord says this. Whether they listen or not, this set of rebels shall know there is a prophet among them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Response is, our eyes are on the Lord till he shows his mercy.
Our eyes are on the Lord till he shows his mercy.
To you I have lifted up my eyes, you who dwell in heavens, my eyes like the eyes of slaves on the hand of their lords.
Our eyes are on the Lord till he shows his mercy.
Like the eyes of a servant on the hand of his mistress, so are our eyes on you, O Lord.
Our eyes are on the Lord, till he show us his mercy.
Have mercy on us, O Lord, have mercy. We are filled with contempt. Indeed, all too full is our soul, with the scorn of the rich, with the proud man's disdain.
Our eyes are on the Lord, till he show us his mercy.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. In view of the extraordinary nature of these revelations,
went to his hometown and his disciples accompanied him. With the coming of the Sabbath, he began teaching in the synagogue, and most of them were astonished when they heard him. They said, "Where did the man get all this? What is this wisdom that has been granted him, and these miracles that are worked through him? This is the carpenter, surely, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and Judah and Simon. His sisters, too, are they not here with us? And they will not accept him." And Jesus said to them, "The prophet is only despised in his own country, among his own relations, and in his own house. And he could work more miracles there, though he cured a few sick people by laying his hands on them. He was amazed at their lack of faith." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
So rather than have like a big meal, you like sort of, you know, three, like you pick and mix, you can sort of take what you want out of three little things, hopefully. But maybe there's something for you in there. I'm still tired, so there we go, that's my excuse. Right, so the first thing, St. Paul the Second really talks about a thorn in his flesh. He says, stop me from being proud. To stop me from thinking that all this amazing thing, all these amazing things that I'm doing, all these people who are coming to believe in Christ through my hand, to stop me from thinking that's me, God keeps giving me a thorn in my flesh. But he doesn't go on to say what that thorn is. What does he mean by that? I think it's something quite private, and that's probably why he doesn't sort of write any more than that. But perhaps all of us, in somehow or another, we can empathize with St. Paul's thorn in the flesh. I mean, for example, is there something that you've done that you bitterly regret? That even years later, you think, oh my God, what was I doing? Is there something, maybe you even confessed it and you know you've been forgiven, and yet every now and then, seemingly in random moments, you think, oh my God, what was I thinking? Why did I allow myself to do that? Yeah? I think it's one of those experiences that Paul is talking about, where there's a thorn in the flesh. Those random memories of things that we said or didn't say, that fill us with, oh, you can feel your stomach dropping as this memories from nowhere comes back and sort of beats us. Oh God, what was I thinking? Why did I do that? And this could have been decades ago, and still it haunts us. Why? If we confess it, if it's gone away, if God has forgiven it, why does it still come back and make us feel awful? gives us the reason.
He says
God allows it, not because he's cruel and likes to see us suffer, not because God likes to remind us of all the bad things that we've done. No, because God wants to remind us of something far, far, far more important than the bad things we've done. God wants us to remind us how he is our strength. Paul says, when I am weak, then I am strong. How does that work? Well, when I am weak, I get out of God's way. When I am weak, when I realize I can't do this, when I am weak, when I realize that the only thing I am good at is messing things up, then I get out of God's way and allow God to be God. Then we are strong. A few years ago, I'm not used to it. I'm going to let you into a secret. But this is a quasi spiritual blackmail, but it's not. In my last parish, there was a particular job we needed doing, and there was somebody who was absolutely perfect for it. But she wouldn't. There's no way she would say yes. Because she'd been asked before, and I couldn't do that, I couldn't do that. And then I really arrived, and this problem arose, and we need someone to fix it, and here's Mrs. X, and she'd be perfect for it, but she'd say no. Spiritual blackmail 101. Mrs. X, would you please do this very important role? No, I'd be no good at that. Exactly, that's why God has chosen you. That's how it works. That's what's going on there. God asks us, not because we're good, not because we're strong, but because we are weak. And the weaker we are, the more we can get out of the way and allow God to be God in our lives. So those random thoughts that come back from maybe, why didn't I think? Those horrible things that come. Next time a memory from the past comes back and wants to beat you and make you feel guilty, stop it right there and say, thank you, God, for making me weak so that I can be strong. That's the first thing. Second one, G Gospel, Jesus in Nazareth. Now, you would think, wouldn't you, of all the people in Israel who would understand Jesus, it would be the people of Nazareth. I mean, they grew up with him. They know his family. If anybody was going to understand him, surely it would have been the people of Nazareth. So why? Why do they reject? Hold that question. Let me ask you another question. In the Creed, in a few moments' time, a few minutes' time, when I eventually shut up, we're going to pray the Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty. Now, Almighty means God can do whatever he wants. Yes? Hello?
Yes.
Did you sleep already?
Yes.
I haven't even started yet. Almighty means God can do whatever he wants. Yes, Father, is the answer. Yes?
Yes, Father.
Wonderful. Yeah. I believe God the Father. Almighty means there's nothing that God can't do. But there is actually, this is the problem. Get your brains working. What is the one thing that God can't do? God is almighty, except what's the one thing Almighty God can't do?
make you love him. The one thing you have that he doesn't is your love. Because the moment he demands it, the moment he forces it, it stops being love. If I make you love me, do you love me already anyway? But yeah. Is that funny? If I make you love me, that's no longer love. If love is forced, it stops being love and becomes something else. You know, the moment you're obliged, the moment you're forced to love, it stops being love by definition. The one thing God Almighty doesn't have, the one thing he doesn't have, the one thing he can't create, is our love. Because love must, it must, by definition, love must be freely given. What's the one thing God doesn't have? It's a good question to ask someone. It's the one thing God doesn't have that only I can give him. My love. And love has to be freely chosen. Now, what we see in that gospel that Jesus is preaching in Nazareth is that the people of Nazareth fought for their own reasons, and they're not bad people. Of course they're not. You know, they're all like the rest of us. But these people have chosen freely, and Jesus respects that choice, but they've chosen to withhold their love. They've already decided, we know who this bloke is, and he's not who he says he is. And they're free to make that choice. In fact, the choice they make is a choice everybody has to make. Is Jesus who he says he is? If he's not, well then we can reject him like the people of Nazareth. But if he is, then we need to freely choose to respond with love. Now, they've made their choice. Well, that's okay. Remember, they're free to, that Jesus respects that. He doesn't call, you know, fire and brimstone out of heaven and burn them up. In the Old Testament, he might have, but this is the New Testament now, so, yeah. They don't do that in the New Testament. But Jesus respects their choice. Why? Because the one thing he desires most, and the one thing he doesn't have, even though he's God Almighty, is our love. Freely given. So will you? Well, after hearing today's gospel, and after hearing the choice the people of Nazareth have made, you know, this man is not who he says he is. What will your response be? What do you think? Is Jesus who he says he is? Is Jesus who he says he is? If he is, what would your response be? If he isn't, what are you doing here? It's the second thing. And then finally, the third thing, and I'll shut up then. Right at the end of the gospel, so after the projector, right at the end of the gospel, Jesus says, a prophet is never welcome in his own land, in his own Why? Why? Because why is a prophet never welcome in his own land?
most of us would prefer a comforting lie to a hard truth. It's as simple as that. You know, prophets, by definition, speak the truth in season and out of season. And most of us, you know, if we're given the choice, in fact, we do it every day, we'd much rather take a comforting lie than a hard truth. You know, how often, and maybe even done it already today, how often do we say things to people we know are not true, but yet we say we don't want to accept them? And when we convince ourselves not being upset is better than being in possession of the truth. Silly, isn't it? You know, when you put it that way, it's really, really quite strange that we do it, but we do. You know, we say not being upset is more important than being in possession of the truth. Okay, but because of that choice we all make, you know, several times a day, a prophet is never welcome, because a prophet always speaks the truth. You know, for example, we live in a culture today that has decided that we can change the definitions of things just to not upset people. You know, we can change the definition of fundamental structures in society. We can change the definition of family. We can change the definition of human dignity. We can change the definition of identity. We can even change biology in order not to upset people. That's how far it goes. And if you stop and point out how ridiculous that is, well, then you have a bigger target. Prophet is never welcome in their homeland, because prophets speak the truth, and quite often we don't want to hear the truth. We'd much rather have a written lie. That's why, as it was in Jesus' day, so it is nowadays. That's why there's so few prophets. But that's also why, as it was in Jesus' day, as it is today, prophets are needed more than ever. Because when so many of us prefer comforting lies, and oh boy, do we need people who are brave enough to speak the truth. You know, when so many of us prefer to receive a lie, then really we do need people who are brave enough, who are willing to risk being rejected, even in their own country, in their hometown, even in their families. And so, the last question for you just to think about maybe this week is, are you a prophet? Are you brave enough to risk not being welcome for the sake of the truth? Or like the people of Nazareth 2,000 years ago, and like many, many people of Sunderland 2,000 years later, are you willing just to reject the truth because the comforting lie is so much more convenient? Where do you stand on that? Are you a prophet, or do you prefer the lies?
One God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things.
Let us now turn to our ever-loving Father and bring our needs before him. We ask you, Lord, to listen to the prayers of your people who come to you in great need of your mercy and your love, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you.
being offered for the intentions of Molly South.
Pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. May this oblation dedicated to your name purify us, O Lord, and day by day bring our conduct closer to the life of heaven, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
And lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, for out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from an ending death, and by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Of the Holy Spirit, all glory.
transformed by divine teaching, we dare to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done upon earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray. Let us pray. Grant we pray, O Lord, that having been replenished by such great gifts, we may gain the prize of salvation and never cease to praise you. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Oh, presents.
Well, first of all, a great thank you. We heard in the gospel of the rejection of Christ by his own people. Over the 40 hours here, and subsequently, has been your rejection.
Yes. Quite right, yeah.
It's been absolutely amazing. And we even got a comment yesterday on Bishop Robert. Even he was impressed.
And that's my praise indeed.
Absolutely. So once again, thank you so much to everyone who came along, everyone who stewarded or made groups of team, but just your presence. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Oh, perfect.
Yeah,
beautiful.
I need to sleep for 40 hours afterwards, but thank you very much. I know it was beautiful. And you can see the flowers and the children's prayers and our own prayer intentions. They'll still be there for a few days more. Summer holidays are coming. Have any of you going overseas? Any risking? Going over to that time? Yeah, okay, no, I'm not either. Yeah. Good luck with that. Please don't get holidays.
I just want to sleep for
it. Exactly. That's why it's good sleep. It's my cool and dark. Anyway, if you are going away, you know, to the weekend, you're going to have a fabulous rest. Stay safe, stay away from viruses and all that sort of stuff. But come back ready. Come back ready, because in September, oh boy, are you going to need to be ready. Because come September, this parish is starting. Just enough, all right? So rest over the summer. Refill. Refresh, spend time in prayer, and be ready. And if you're not going away, that's fine as well. Jesus is already here in Sunderland. Why would you want to leave sunny Sunderland? I can't possibly imagine. That's about it for announcements. Oh, no, there's not. The Northern Cross is sort of a venerable journal of all sorts of things, Catholic and local. It's on sale at the back of the church for £1.50, I think, which is an absolute bargain for the amount of information. Honestly, we have got a new sound system coming, I promise you. It should have been. Why was it so last year? It is coming, I promise you. It's just in the meantime, the old one. That's all right, it's our thorn in the flesh. But no, the Northern Cross is available. Alan McElveny would love to relieve more money in exchange for a copy. Just see him at the back of the church on the way out. Have a very, very blessed week. Thank you, guys. It was amazing. You're not here next week, are you? Are you? Next week in that aura. We'll see you next week. Bye. God bless you. Have a very, very blessed week. So if you're going away, have a wonderful trip. If you stay, wonderful as well. The Lord be with you.
Amen.